Greetings, Earthlings. This is another quick inbox review. This is of a new kit from Tamiya, the World War I British Tank Mark IV Male. This is quite a new kit from Japan. It's a little bit strange in that it's motorised, which is kind of a very 1970s thing to do. For some reason, they must have the marketing department of Tamiya must have thought that was a good idea. The good news is I don't think that it'll make much difference to the accuracy of the kit to have the motorisation gear in it. We'll take a bit more of a look at that in a moment. This is obviously a World War I tank. It was one of the very first tanks sort of ever built. This is the basic design of it. What's known as a rhomboidal design, and the idea was that it allowed the it allowed the tank to cross trenches, because if you imagine the edges of the trench would come up to here, and as the tank tipped over, the horns here at the front, as they were called, would fall on the far edge of the trench, and it'd be able to drag itself over. So quite a clever design. Another thing that's interesting about it is that the underside here, this bottom run of tracks here, is not flat. You'd expect it just to be flat, but in fact there's a gentle curve, and the tank actually only stands on kind of this very, very small section here, and that's to make it easier to steer. Now, the original versions, the Mark 1s, actually had a set of wheels at the back to help them steer. They were like enormous pram wheels almost stuck out the back on a trolley to help them steer. But they were a bit of a liability. They tend to get caught in wire and tangled up and broken. And it caused so many problems that they were deleted for later versions. So this is a Mark IV. Which was the most widely used mark of British tank during the First World War, actually used quite widely by the British and the Germans, and we'll come to that in a sec. The Mark I obviously was the first tank to be used, and saw action in the Battle of the Somme, or the Somme Offensive, in September of 1915. And there was a Mark II which had some minor improvements, but it was only really designed for training. There's some debate as to whether or not they were even armoured. A lot of them seem to be made of mild steel. a few of them were used actually anyway, but they were generally only used for training. The Mark III again was a few incremental advances, and again really only used for training. It was intended that the Mark IV would see a major improvement over the previous marks of tank, because it was actually a very difficult beast to drive. There was a driver and a commander here in this sort of cupola here, and the driver's job mostly was to change gear. The commander had a pair of steering levers, which had brakes on to slow down one or other sort of track, but most of the steering was actually handled by a couple of what were known as guardsmen, who were actually kind of stationed in the rear of the tank here, and they had some gear levers, and their job actually was to change the gear of the runs of the track individually, and there were a couple of different gears to choose. That couldn't be done while the tank was moving, believe it or not. So in order to turn, the tank actually had to stop, and then the relevant gears had to be chosen on either side, and then the driver would put the main engine into gear and then drive off again, and it would slew round to one way or the other. So you can imagine that was a spectacularly difficult way to proceed, and it was intended that the Mark IV tanks would have a much better steering mechanism. In the event, that didn't happen, and the new steering mechanism, the the Merritt Wilson gearbox actually wasn't available for the Mark IVs, and went into the Mark Vs, which came right at the end of the war. But the Mark IVs were needed anyway, so they were just fitted with the usual Daimler engine and gearbox, and still had the very ungainly steering. So anyway, that's a quick history of the tank. Let's have a quick look and see what's inside it. Right. Now I've had a quick look in here already, which is why all the instructions and things are at the top. a quick little erratum sheet there, or really just gives you a bit more information of how to attach some of the sprockets. An instruction sheet and a very nice booklet here that gives you a bit of information about the tanks, as well as a rather handy little diagram there that tells you what all the parts were called. There's information here in Japanese, English, German and French, and on the other side of it we have painting guide, and the painting guide is for three vehicles, all of them British, not surprisingly. Two from November 1917, which is where these, basically when these tanks first saw action, and one from it says location unknown, but it'll be the spring of or summer of 1918. Now the two earlier tanks are named. One's called Hyacinth, one's called Black Arrow 2, but the later one isn't. But the later one has these red and white recognition stripes on it. it was kind of decided that I don't know, it seemed a bit soft and stupid to give tanks names. I think it's a bit of a shame, really, but so it was decided that that would officially be discontinued as a practice. And so the later tanks didn't have that. But what they did have were these recognition stripes here. And the reason that British tanks were given these white and red stripes was that by this stage, quite a few tanks, about 40 or so actually, had been captured by the Germans and pressed into use against the British, and so the British could no longer rely on the fact that every tank that they saw was one of theirs, and so they had to be able to identify which was theirs and which belonged to the dastardly Hun, and these stripes were an idea to help do that. As you can see, everything is brown. There's only, apart from those stripes, everything is this sort of khaki brown colour. Tamiya give you a mix for that from X-52 and X-55. There are, I know that Ammo by MiG has just come out with a new set of colours for this tank. Also on this sheet is a set of photographs of the real thing. This is from the Mark IV that now lives at the Tank Museum in Bovington. There are a couple of other Mark IVs still surviving. There's a Mark IV female somewhere in Russia. There is one at Ashford in Kent, which bizarrely was used for a while as an electricity substation. There is a one in the Tank Museum in Brussels, which actually is still in its original colours, which is interesting. And there's one in Australia. I think that's all of the Mark IVs. The one in the Tank Museum in Bovington apparently is still in running order, though they never run it, just in case it breaks, because it's probably very hard to get the spares now. Anyway, onto the instructions. I won't go through these in much detail because basically you've seen them before, this type of thing. There's lots of stuff here about fitting the motors and electrical gear, but I'm going to ignore that. I'm not going to bother fitting that stuff. I don't really want to drive it along the carpet. So all of it's very straightforward, lots of flat panels mostly. Lots and lots, I should say, of wheels. There are quite a few. I mean, I was taken aback at just how many wheels of different types these tanks had. The wheels were not sprung, by the way. They were just bolted to axles, so it must have been a fairly rough ride. More fitment of sprockets and what have you, and here we are fitting the sponsons. There is a bit of interior detail to the sponsons. They have, you can best make out here, they have a breech and sight mechanism here. Unfortunately, that's all there is inside them, really. There's not really enough to open them up, and you can see here, in fact, that the this is the where the breech of this machine gun should be, and in fact, there's just a little nub there. So, I'm not quite sure why Tamiya bothered to do that. It seems, I suppose it's a start, and if you want to go on and add more detail yourself, you can. But I was hoping that it was going to be a properly detailed sort of thing, so you could have the door open, but it really isn't. The tracks are interesting. The tracks are made of individual link tracks, and they kind of click together. Which, knowing Tamiya, they probably will click together, and they probably will work quite well. And other than that, there's nothing really remarkable about this. So, as I said, I'm going to ignore the motorized aspects of it, and I'm going to just build it as a static model. Okay, let's have a look at what's actually inside the box. First of all, there's some bits here for motorization. There's some sort of drivetrain type gears, and there's sort of ABS. A box full of a box a bag rather full of bits like battery boxes. This is the motor and sort of gearbox here in one unit. Some metal sprockets and lots of screws and a screwdriver and some grease. These are the sponsons where the 6 pounder guns are fitted. This is a male tank, and so it has 6 pounder guns. The female was fitted with a smaller sponson, but with two machine guns in it. I think they actually made more females than males, so this is a relatively rare beastie. So lots of tracks. These are the track parts, individual links that will just kind of click together. So hopefully they will work as advertised. This is a sort of a sprulet here with the 6 pounder guns on it and the gun shield to fit on the sponsons. Here we have lots of wheels, lots of wheels, and the sprockets and idlers. There are two identical sprues for this. Sprue that holds the main parts of the body of the tank. That's the roof. That's the floor. The sort of stern plate there with an inspection hatch, and various other sort of parts there, the drivers and commanders hatches. Fairly straightforward build. I don't think there's anything there that made me think that's, having looked through the instructions, that makes me think that's actually going to be difficult to build. Some very, very nice detail on some of these panels here with these rivets around the outside. So that'll look very nice, I think, with a nice wash over it to bring out the detail. Final sprue, or bag rather, contains the side parts. These are the horns where the idlers fit. These are the tail parts where the sprockets actually go in here. And these are the side sections, and these are where the sponsons will fit. And finally, we have a set of decals, and some stickers, little warning stickers that I can't see anybody ever using, that just warn that the tank will get hot and that it might move. So that's it for what's in the tank. There is something that that's potentially interesting. I'll just point out. If you notice the way that these areas are moulded, you'll see that these parts where the sponsons fit are a separate part. Now, the female tanks, as I said, have a smaller sponson. It's not as deep, and it contains two machine guns. So these parts will need to be changed for a female tank. You would also need to change the armament, and you'll notice that these sort of end bits of this sprue here have a gate here to allow the sprue to be swapped out when it's moulded. And of course the sponsons themselves are on a completely separate sprue. So I would tend to conclude from that if there isn't a new female version of this tank actually being planned, then this one was certainly built with the possibility of doing one in mind. So you never know, there might be a female Mark IV coming out fairly soon, and with any luck it might even not be motorised. Okay, that's your lot. I was looking forward to this kit, and I'm not really disappointed with it. I mean, I don't really care about the motorisation stuff, I will just discard that. the kit looks like typical Tamiya quality, really nicely moulded, and looks fairly well engineered. I assume it's going to fit together well. Tamiya kits almost always do. And it's good to see a new modern kit of this very important tank. Now there's a lot more sort of World War I stuff coming out. TACOM of course have their Saint-Chamond. Meng have two FT-17s and a Char-2C. TACOM have also announced some Mark IVs, a British, a male one and a female one, which should be interesting. Hobby Boss have just announced a Schneider CA, which is another sort of French tank. So we are pretty much tanked up, as it were. There's not many more to do. Hopefully someone will come out with the Germans' own domestically produced vehicle, which was the A7V, which looks like basically a bungalow on tracks. And I'm hoping still for my own sort of favourite one, which is the Whippet, the relatively fast, relatively light British tank that was used right at the end of the war. So yeah, exciting times if you're interested in First World War stuff. The only other thing I was going to say was that this is the Japanese boxing of this kit, and this actually came from straight from Japan. The ink's still tacky on it, you know, that's how new it is. But in the UK and I think the US and probably anywhere except for Japan, this will not be quite the same. You'll probably have a different box. And the reason for that is that you'll also find in the box this set here of World War I British soldier figures. So there's an officer and a few infantrymen and a machine gunner there. So I think that will be included with most of the export versions. I assume it will push the price up as well, so I don't think that'll be stuck in there for free. And I think it'll be about £50 for the UK version, which is a little bit more than I paid for this one. Still, anyway, I think this kit leads itself well to being used for dioramas. and with the figures with it as well, I think it'll be a really really interesting thing. Right, that must have bored you pretty much all to tears. I hope that was of interest to you, and I hope you'll comment and let me know what you think. I don't think it's going to be too long before I get stuck into this. I really like the look of this. It looks like a fairly straightforward and fun build. As and when I get onto it, I will be sure to post. Okay, thanks very much for your time. Until next time, happy modelling.